This series of images is titled Silent World, and it's by Paris-based creative partnership Lucy and Simon. The photographs depict famously busy places, but in a state of eerily quiet abandonment. Lone figures can be seen wandering these desolate landscapes, creating scenes reminiscent of post-apocalyptic films. You can almost hear their footsteps echoing around these familiar, yet unfamiliar vistas. And while these shots may look slightly reminiscent of scenes we saw during lockdown, these images actually predate the pandemic by a good few years. So when it comes to places that are always busy, packed with people and cars 24 hours of the day, how do you create empty images like this? Well, there are a few factors involved, but it starts with taking images with a very long exposure. One of the things that makes long exposure photography so striking is how it has the power to completely alter your viewer's whole perception of a place. Because with long exposure, you're dealing with an extended passage of time that's compressed down to a single image. It's a form of photography that's very far removed from making images of the world we experience in day-to-day life. You can use it to create images that play with our perception of reality. Images can be more surreal, more dreamlike. But long exposure is also a great way to make your shot immediately say, "This photograph is not a snapshot." It gives your work a gravitas that commands attention, and it can also bring out the best in you as a photographer because it forces you to take your time and to think about every detail of your shot. But there's a lot more you can do with long exposure than you might think. It's so much more than just light trail night shots of cities and those black and white art images of the sea. There are so many creative and interesting ways you as a photographer can utilize long exposure to make images that really capture people's attention. So this video is going to be divided into two parts. Firstly, I'd like to show you some examples of artists that use long exposure in very interesting and creative ways. And the second part will be a few tips on how to take successful long exposures. So let's get started. So how did Lucy and Simon remove all those people from the scenes in their Silent World series? The answer is that they used dark, neutral density filters to create long exposure images. And these images are exposed over such a long time that anything moving in the shot simply vanishes. The longer the shutter is open for, the less of an impact any moving object has on the final image. A faster shutter speed will render a crisp, sharp capture of any motion. A slower shutter speed will start to blur the motion. A super long shutter speed will start to make all traces of that object vanish completely. For example, this is a quick picture I took of a busy street taken at 1/340th of a second. People are frozen in motion. That same shot taken at 1/8th of a second still shows the figures, but they're blurred. The traffic looks stationary because it was waiting at a red traffic light. Had the light been green, the traffic would look more blurred. This is a good shutter speed to use if you're taking commercial photos of spaces and buildings. 1/5 to 1/8th of a second is generally what I use when doing that kind of work, as it still shows recognisable figures to show the space in use and the scale, but their identity is hidden, and so the focus of the shot remains on the space and not on the people. So coming back to this shot of a busy street, if we were to use a 10-stop neutral density filter and slow the shutter duration down to 2 minutes, the figures and traffic begin to completely vanish, with the exception of these two people here, who were stood still for the entire duration of the exposure. I know that Lucy and Simon must also have used some compositing in these shots. These flags, these trees, this person, the clouds, these would all be blurred out by movement. These must have been brought in from a shot at a much faster shutter speed, fast enough to freeze motion. This is a fairly simple thing to do in Photoshop, if you're taking multiple shots on a stationary tripod. But it's the editing of these small details that tricks our brain into reading these images as captures of one frozen moment in time, and therefore a depiction of a reality that more closely resembles the world how we experience it. British artist Darren Almond takes long exposure night photos lit only by the moon in his series Full Moon and Nocturne. On initial glance, these images could be mistaken for daytime, but there's an ethereal strangeness to the light. As he keeps the shutter open for periods upwards of 15 minutes at a time, the moon moves across the sky, which creates soft shadows. Colours appear subtly different to how we perceive them in the day, and in some of the images, we can see the trails left by stars as the Earth rotates beneath them. There's a surreal dreamlike quality to these landscapes. Almond shows us stunning vistas, colourful fields of flowers, the sorts of places we've seen in photographs many times before, but there's something unsettling about these images. For me, these places seem indescribably wrong. They feel slightly unnerving, like I shouldn't be there. They're real landscapes, but they're presented to us in a way that we cannot see with the naked eye. Almond has created a fascinating view of the world we know, but with an underlying magical and sometimes ominous quality. While long exposure can be used to remove moving elements within an image, like we saw with Lucy and Simon, it can also be used to accentuate movement. In Alexei Titarenko's project City of Shadows, Titarenko uses long exposures to make images of mass movements of crowds. He depicts people commuting in St. Petersburg in the early 1990s, following the dissolution of the Soviet Union. The extended duration of the shutter creates a feeling of movement, while the figures become a homogenized group that flow almost like water. The city around them stays static and lifeless. This removal of people's individuality, combined with the image's monochromatic nature, communicates a real sense of feeling. Titarenko has done a great job in capturing what I can only imagine was the mood resulting from the economic situation of the time. In direct opposition to Titarenko's monochromatic, crowded urban scenes, Henry Priestdays uses minimal but vibrant colour to evoke a strong feeling in his imagery. He uses long exposure to capture the ambient light of night scenes and then boosts its saturation in post. This results in colourful yet strangely atmospheric scenes, where light that may appear a little more subdued in reality bursts through trees and doorways like some alien spaceship from a science fiction film. Often shooting in foggy conditions and with his selective colour palette, his work has a soft, minimal quality to it, yet it maintains a vibrancy through its strong use of colour. His work has a very cinematic feel to it. This is partly due to the way he works with colour, but also because the photographs have a strong sense of narrative to them, like there's a story to be unearthed behind each of his images. Photographer Hiroshi Sugimoto took long exposures of entire movies in his project Theatres. He set his camera at the back of the cinema, opening the shutter at the start of the film and not closing it until the film had finished. In a way, he's capturing the entirety of the film while simultaneously erasing it, reducing the thousands of frames of information down to a static rectangle of white light that illuminates a deserted movie theatre. You could call this a portrait of a movie, but the resulting images don't communicate this. The locations take on a haunting quality, a vision of places forced out of their context. I think there's something interesting about images of places we usually see people shown, with no people present. I explored the concept of liminal spaces in my video on Todd Heido's work, which you can see on my channel. This removal of people from once busy places triggers a deeply human feeling that I, the viewer, should also not be there. Sugimoto's images of deserted movie theatres are no exception to this, and I experience the same uneasy feeling when looking at these images. This is further exacerbated by the surreal quality of the glowing white rectangle. That space that we stare at that fills us with excitement, with fear, laughter, emotion. All of that information, those 24 images every second, is gone. And in its place, nothing. No data. Blankness. A void of white. I recently visited the Natural History Museum's Wildlife Photographer of the Year exhibition, which is always full of fantastic images, but this highly commended entry really caught my eye. It's called Mushroom Magic by Jorgen Foyn. This image shows us bioluminescent ghost fungus growing in the rainforests of Queensland, Australia. But as this fungus's glow is barely visible to the naked eye, Foyn created this image by merging 8 300 second long exposures together. The long exposures enable us to see a dramatically boosted effect of the light that's produced by this fungus, creating this stunning image. So looking at these six examples of photographers and artists who are using long exposure to do different and interesting things, I think the overarching message we can take from this is don't always do the expected. Stray from the beaten track, experiment a little. Don't just copy what other people are already doing, but instead think what unique message that you can communicate. Think about time, think about movement, about light. How can you use long exposure to play with and alter these elements? But in order to do that, first you must know how to achieve the effects you want. And that brings me on to part two of this video, how to get good long exposures. Right, you will need a camera with some sort of lens, a good sturdy tripod, one that will hold your camera nice and still. And if you want to shoot in daylight, you really should get a dark ND or neutral density filter. I'm using an ND1000 filter here, which I picked up on Amazon. An ND1000 filter cuts your light by 10 stops. You can get all different levels of darkness with ND filters. An ND2 is one stop darker, that's half the light. An ND4 is two stops darker, that's one quarter of the light. An ND8, three stops darker, 1/8 of the light, etc. And if you don't know what a stop is, it's a relative term for how we measure light. Relative in that you can increase or decrease light by X number of stops, but it isn't something you can measure the brightness of light with like you can with lumens. You couldn't, for example, say that a light is 5 stops bright. It would only be 5 stops brighter than another light. One stop brighter is double the light, and one stop darker is half the light. So an ND1000 is very dark. 10 stops, or about 1/1000th of the light that you would get if you didn't have the filter. So dark that you have to focus the camera before you put the filter on the lens, because you and your camera won't be able to see through it in normal daylight. You can get variable ND filters too. You twist these and they get darker and lighter. And these are great for things like video, but they're not so good for long exposure still images, as it makes it a lot of guesswork rather than properly calculated exposure times. And when you're being so meticulous about a single shot, you should make sure that you're in control of how the image is exposed. When you're dealing with exposures that could last 5, 10, 20 minutes or more, you don't really want to be blindly guessing at your camera settings. And you can do long exposures without ND filters. This is fairly easy at night, but in the day you will struggle to go past a few seconds. I recommend getting a darker ND, 9 stops or 10 stops, because it gives you more versatility. This shot, for example, was taken at 1/60th of a second without any filter. You can see a lot of texture on the surface of the water. When I cranked the aperture right down to f/32, I was able to get an exposure of 1/3 of a second, but that doesn't do very much here. Putting an ND64 on this lens, which cuts out 6 stops of light, I was able to get an exposure of 15 seconds, which is long, but there's still some texture left on the water. However, switching that out for a 10-stop filter, an ND1000, I was able to get an exposure of 240 seconds, or 4 minutes. And here, we can see that the water has become perfectly smooth like glass. Turn that black and white, add some contrast to enhance those textures, and we have a much more interesting shot than the first one we took at 1/60th of a second. I would avoid the cheapest of the cheap ND filters, as these can produce some nasty colour casts, but in my experience, it's diminishing returns. I haven't found that much of a noticeable difference between a mid-range ND filter and some of the more super expensive high-end filters. There's a load of different YouTube videos out there, and they all tell you how to set up your camera for long exposures, and they vary a little. And this is because there's no definitive way of doing it, because it kind of depends on the effect you want to achieve and the camera you're using. However, there are some universal rules that you should follow. Firstly, if you want your composition to be static, you'll need to put your camera somewhere where it won't move. This generally means a good tripod that's weighted down. The smallest of vibrations can ruin your shot. If it's windy, you'll need something extra sturdy to fix your camera to. But also, you want to avoid anywhere where the ground might be moving. This could be bridges that vibrate when people walk by, like Millennium Bridge in London with its metal walkways, or it could be wooden boards that are bending slightly as people walk over them. Find somewhere nice and sturdy, some concrete path or something. So for the camera settings themselves, you should set your ISO, aperture, and exposure time all to manual. If you've not shot in manual mode before, don't worry, it's not as difficult as you think. Different cameras deal with exposure time differently. A lot of cameras will have a maximum of 30 seconds in manual mode, so you might want to switch to bulb mode or time mode if you're using a Fujifilm camera. You also want to turn off any automatic pop-up flashes. Turn off any image stabilization settings in your camera or on the lens. You don't want to risk your camera accidentally compensating for movement and vibrations that aren't there. Many digital cameras will have a long exposure noise reduction feature. And what this does is it tries to eliminate all digital noise, hot pixels, other artifacts by taking a duplicate exposure after the first. The difference with the second exposure being that it does it with the shutter closed, meaning that it doesn't capture any light from the scene you're shooting. It only captures any imperfections created by the sensor. It then subtracts those imperfections from the first image. And this is a great feature, but it effectively does double the amount of time your exposure takes. And when you're exposing for a long time, that can be quite annoying, and it also puts more drain on your battery. So it's up to you whether you want to use this or not. I generally turn it off, especially if I'm shooting in the evening when the light is changing and I only have a limited amount of time to nail that exposure. Set your ISO to the lowest it goes. This gives you a nice clean image and enables you to shoot for longer. Decide on your aperture based on how deep you want your depth of field. If you're not using an ND filter, you'll probably need to keep your aperture quite small, somewhere around f11 or smaller. Be aware that when you stop your lens down to a very small aperture, any light sources in your shot can start to produce a starburst effect. Now you can use this creatively to add some atmosphere to your shot, but be conscious of the fact that this can become very distracting if it's overused. Don't automatically go for a wide lens. The longer your focal length, the more opportunity you have to cut down the information in your shot, especially if you're shooting at night. It's tempting to find a scene filled with lights and to compose an image, and this can look great, but I've often found that too many light sources in your shot can make your shot become visually confusing. Just shooting one or two lights can help focus your viewer's attention. If you're shooting at night in a city, it's sometimes good to use a pro mist filter, as this can add some haze to your light sources. It can add a lot of atmosphere, and these come in different strengths. I don't recommend going over a 1/4 strength, as your photo can start to take on a bit too much of a soft focus look. Unless you're using a really old film camera, your camera will have a built-in light meter. This will give you an idea of what your exposure time should be. Adjust the time until your meter shows that the image is neither under or overexposed. That'll be when the indicator is sitting right in the middle. So now is the time to add that ND filter if you're using one. Focus your camera before you put the filter on, and then switch your focus to manual to lock it in. After you put an ND on your lens, your camera will probably not have enough light information to be able to focus, and it's very unlikely you'll be able to see anything through the lens. Some cameras will still be able to give you a light meter reading with the ND on. If it can't, you'll need to use the reading you took before you added the filter. All you need to do is multiply the exposure time by the number of the filter. For example, with an ND1000 filter, which is 10 stops of light, you'll need to multiply your exposure time by 1000. So if your camera was saying that the shot should be 1/125th of a second, you'll want your exposure to be around 8 seconds. This is because 1/125th of a second times 1000 is 8 seconds. If your camera says the exposure should be 1/8th of a second, an exposure of around 2 minutes will work, as 1/8th of a second times 1000 is about 125 seconds, or just over 2 minutes. If all this math sounds too complicated, then there are some great apps you can get that will do all this for you. Lee Filters does one called Lee Stopper, Nissi Filters does one too. You simply input your shutter speed and the filter that you're using, and it will give you the time you need to expose for. You can also tweak the settings by adjusting your ISO and aperture. It depends on what's important for you in the shot. If a shallow depth of field is important to your shot, then use a wide aperture and then compensate with a faster shutter speed. If you want to smooth out water or get really long light trails, you'll need to use a longer exposure, and then you can compensate by closing down your aperture. When taking the shot itself, I recommend using either a remote trigger or a self timer on the camera. This ensures that there won't be any vibration from your hand as you press the shutter button. Although, the longer your exposure time, the less this matters. The impact of some initial vibrations will be a lot more prominent on a 3-second exposure as opposed to a 20-minute exposure. If you're shooting film, make sure you account for reciprocity failure. This is basically where the film gets less sensitive to the light the longer it's exposed. And this doesn't happen with digital sensors. The extent to which this happens varies from film stock to film stock, but there's a lot of information online about how to compensate for this. So make sure you research the particular stock you're using beforehand. If you've never tried long exposure photography, I highly recommend giving it a go. It changes how a place feels, and it can open up so many creative avenues that you may not have thought of for your own work. You could composite shots together with a fast shutter speed and a slow shutter speed. You could create a surreal scene like that, like Lucy and Simon did with Silent World. Or you could make night look like day, like Darren Almond. Or better still, you could find your own unique way of using long exposure to communicate something new. Do the unexpected. Be a pioneer. Because it's very much a style of photography that lends itself well to experimentation. You're only really limited by your own creativity. I'll see you next time.